now our feature program.
I feel like the first time I met Jackie Robinson was at Shibe Park. I had a 50-cent bleacher seat, and he hit a line drive home run right to where I was sitting, just a couple seats down. And I saw the ball, guy showed me the ball, the guy that caught it. For some reason, I felt like I met him that night, or I became a part of him that night.
It was critical that Jackie was such a good athlete. It was critical that he carried his weight, that he was not an affirmative action for the player.
I told him one time, I said, Jack, look, man, these guys are throwing at you. They're not throwing at you because you're black. They just don't like you, that's all. And he didn't. He'd just laugh about it, that's all. But he would absolutely dare you to throw at him.
And I think that was his tendency, that he dealt with fear in action, by taking action. But that wasn't the man who we saw at home. He was a tender, loving, wonderful companion.
At the end of Jesse Jackson's eulogy for Jackie Robinson, the Reverend Jackson said he got tired. He stole home. A little while after that, in a bar on Broadway, Irving Rudd, the Dodger publicist, said, if Jackie stole home, right now he's complaining to St. Peter. That was a lousy call. I was only 52. Robinson's arrival in the major leagues had as much potential to destroy baseball as it did to emancipate the game. He's been called a social guinea pig, a pioneer, a prophet, and a son of a bitch. He could be any or all. But mostly, I remember a man who risked everything, even his life, for what he believed in.
Jack Roosevelt Robinson was born in Cairo, Georgia, on the same plantation his grandparents once worked as slaves. In 1920, when Jack was 6 months old, his father hopped a Florida-bound train with another man's wife. Mally Robinson had to fend for herself and five small children in a brutal South.
Mally began as a young woman to challenge the system when she was a sharecropper, and decided that if she couldn't renegotiate her arrangement with the tenant farmer, she would not continue in that job. And so she carried that on, that attitude toward the system and toward herself throughout her life. And Jack certainly saw that as a way of coping, that is standing up and fighting back.
Mally crammed her family's worldly goods into two tattered suitcases and boarded a train bound for the promised land, Pasadena, California. 3 days later, the train pulled into Los Angeles. For the first time, Mally saw the lights of a big city flickering off in the distance at the foot of the San Gabriel Mountains. She wrote her former teacher back in Georgia.
Tell all my girlfriends I climbed mountains so tall, the tops were hidden in the clouds. Our train was so long that on the sharpest curves you could lean out of the last car and light a cigarette by the fire in the engine. It was the most beautiful sight of my whole life.
Working two jobs as a domestic, Mally saved enough for a modest down payment on a house in a mostly white section of Pasadena. It quickly became the center of activity for neighborhood kids. The Robinson House at 121 Pepper Street was simply known as the castle.
We bought the castle 3 years after we got here, so I think back, my mother must have been working pretty hard. I know she was gone every day, but she tried to be home before dark. And we had to be in the yard. We'd do our work before we could go and play.
I lived on Glen Avenue at that time, which was about three blocks up and a couple over. Mallie Robinson was a very loving person and would put her arms around kids in the neighborhood, and it was just nice, very nice.
Despite Mallie's castle, she could not hide her children from bigotry. It was here Jackie Robinson auditioned for his future role in the country's noble experiment.
There was one couple. I feel sorry for them. They were in their 80s, and they hadn't been around blacks. And we go, my mother had passed across the street, because they were on our side, to go to the store. And then they were still afraid. They'd go out for their walk. They stopped going out, and they wouldn't come. And they see us coming from there, from down the street. Then they rush in the house.
There were stories of attempts to buy her out. There were stories of her being threatened with having her house burned down. They wanted her out one way or another. And it was not subtle. It was blatant, and she knew about it. And she didn't propose to move. So her effort then was to train her children to live in that hostile environment. The man across the street had a daughter, and she started, Jack was sweeping the sidewalk on his side of the street, and they started throwing rocks at him and calling him nigger. And he returned that effort by throwing rocks back at them and calling them crackers.
He was about 7, 8. And they fought it out, and I look over there, and I said, why the old man out there throwing rocks? You know he can't throw better than Jack, and he can't catch him.
As a teenager, Jack joined a local gang. The two Robinson boys, Jackie and Mac, were its leaders. The Pepper Street Gang became the focal point of the Pasadena police.
Of course, the term gang then wasn't like the term gang now. All they did was sit on the curb and talk. And it was, they had Negroes, Japanese, and Mexican in this gang group. And I knew them all.
We were in Pasadena when they put the street lights up. And that was heaven to them, and that was part of the things, the mischief, because they got to break it light every day.
Late one night, the Pepper Street Gang was caught swimming in the town's reservoir. All 16 members were hauled off to jail at gunpoint. For the next 4 hours, the gang members were interrogated under hot lights. The sheriff sent out for watermelon. Suffering from near heat exhaustion, the boys gladly ate off the floor. A deputy laughed as he took pictures, claiming this proved the myth about blacks and watermelons. Jackie later recalled this as the greatest humiliation he had ever suffered. At the age of 18, Robinson won a scholarship from Pasadena Junior College, where he lettered in 4 sports. He set a national AAU long jump record and led California junior colleges in scoring.
He went to a meet, I forget exactly where it was. He had a baseball game the same day. Some pals of his drove him there. The car broke down along the way. He got to the meet. There were no warm-ups. Set this broad jump record, which I think at the time was 25-something feet. It was a national AAU record. His friends drive him back to this baseball game. He could do anything at any time he wanted, he felt.
If you had to pick 10 of the great athletes in America, you'd have to make Jackie Robinson one of them, and I don't know who the other 9 would be.
When White Sox manager Jimmy Dykes saw the young shortstop play baseball, he told reporters Robinson could play in the big leagues on a moment's notice. But no one took Dykes' comments seriously. To most college recruiters, the name Jackie Robinson described an uppity black kid with a reputation as a troublemaker.
He was seeking something. He was searching for a place in the world for himself, and he was using his talents to do it. And yes, he was highly competitive, but he believed in excellence.
In 1939, UCLA signed Robinson to a football scholarship. He joined All-American Kenny Washington and his childhood friend Ray Bartlett in the UCLA backfield. Shortly after he signed a letter of intent, Robinson almost lost his scholarship.
I think I started the whole thing. Some white guy drove up by us, and I think Jack had a an old Plymouth then, and I would think I was riding on the running board, and this guy made some comment about nigger this or something or other, and I responded right away with my glove right across his face, and he got angry and drove across the street, and then he and I thought we were going to fight, but Jack got in it, and we couldn't get Jack out of it. The cops came up, and everybody was trying to get Jack to withdraw, but he wouldn't. Even in practice, she had to win. And I think he had that kind of personality and that kind of inner strength that just rubbed off on teammates, because it was we can do it type thing. Not if, but we can do it. So let's get at it.
Robinson survived the furor and became the first four-letter athlete at UCLA. In his junior year, he led the country in rushing with 11 yards per carry. In basketball, he led the Pacific Coast Conference in scoring. But in college, the sport for which he would become famous was the one in which he excelled the least.
He played a good baseball game at junior college. But when he got to UCLA, he couldn't hit for diddly. I think he only batted .097, but he was a tremendous defensive man. I don't know what happened after he left UCLA.
Robinson's sophomore year, he met Rachel Isom, a second-year student studying to become a nurse.
I think the intelligence of Rachel was really a guiding feature, I think, in Jack's life. My personal opinion, I think it toned him down. It made him a little more considerate of things and other people, and not spark his temper so quickly. I think that was really the greatest thing she did, was keeping him so that he kept himself under control.
He was proud of his color and didn't refrain from doing things that had accentuated it. And and I was less sophisticated about that and less willing to display myself in a way that would accentuate my color. And I took that as a lesson for me, that he could do it and do it with pride.
In 1943, Branch Rickey, a devoutly religious man, took over as the new Dodger president.
When he went over to the Dodgers in 43, there were almost no players in the Dodger system other than Pee Wee Reese who went on to be significant factors with any of the Dodger success in later years. The thrust was on developing the farm system, getting a large base of talent.
In 1943, Rickey told George McLaughlin, president of the Brooklyn Trust Company, of his plan one day to sign a black man to a Dodger contract. If it's games you're looking to win, fine, McLaughlin stated. But if you're looking to emancipate the Negro race, then forget it. The following year, Rickey teamed with John L. Smith and with Walter O'Malley, the team attorney, to buy 75% of the outstanding shares of the Dodgers. Now, Rickey had to convince his fellow stockholders to support his plan to sign a black player.
And when they said, yes, we'll go with a black ball player, Rickey became Abraham Lincoln. But they had to say yes first.
Rickey would eventually spend $35,000 of the team's money to find the right man to break baseball's silent code. But an unlikely element prodded Rickey toward his eventual decision.
The Communist Party, for obvious reasons, had long agitated for not only integration throughout the society, but very particularly for the integration of Major League Baseball. There was the sports editor of the Daily Worker was a guy who organized all kinds of letter writing campaigns was a constant needle in the side of Major League Baseball on behalf of integration.
There was a campaign led by specifically the Communist Party, two city councilmen in New York, Pete Cascione and Ben Davis Jr., one white, one black. Ben Davis was elected to the city council in Harlem, had generated a whole movement in New York centered around the city council resolutions. So there was a growing movement led by communist union people and many just ordinary baseball fans, liberals and others, on this very issue.
The great bass baritone Paul Robeson, a former football All-American and now a leading actor and political activist, led a delegation of communists and the Negro press to meet baseball commissioner Kennesaw Mountain Landis and all 16 owners. Robeson spoke eloquently. Following Landis's orders, the owners gave no response. Branch Rickey, too, said nothing.
But it helped generate a big grassroots movement because it opened the door, cracked the door, and that stimulated a nationwide grassroots movement among both blacks and whites to have that barrier broken.
In Brooklyn, Peter Cascione, the first communist elected to the New York City Council, spearheaded a drive that collected 10,000 signatures urging baseball to break its color barrier. In 1943, Lieutenant Jackie Robinson was transferred to Camp Hood in Texas. Black soldiers called it the hellhole. At Camp Hood, he was removed from a bus and court-martialed for failing to observe strict Jim Crow laws.
When he got out of the military, I think he was extremely concerned that the limited opportunities he had would be further limited by the troubles he had in the Army.
In 1944, Robinson joined Satchel Paige on the Kansas City Monarchs in the Negro Leagues. Robinson was offered $300 a month. He held out for an extra $100. Around the country, more and more whites were speaking out against baseball's color barrier.
There was pressure for unity against Hitlerism, and Hitlerism meant racism. And if you were uniting against Hitler, you're uniting against racism. And if you're uniting against racism, you can't practice racism right here at home.
In private, Branch Rickey, along with his son, Branch II, wrestled with a plan. When would he make his move, and with whom would he make it? 1945, Bear Mountain, New York. The Brooklyn Dodgers' wartime spring training camp. While the country was celebrating victory overseas, the communists made their most ambitious move. Led by the Daily Worker, a communist group showed up unannounced at Bear Mountain with two Negro League players, Terrace McDuffie and Showboat Thomas. Neither player was major league caliber, but the Worker demanded a tryout. A furious Branch Rickey had no choice but to oblige. After the tryout, Rickey lambasted the Communist Party, slammed the Negro Leagues as rackets, and announced his plan to form a third Negro League.
The owners agreed to put up, to establish a committee with myself, Branch Rickey, and Larry MacPhail to search out a means of producing a fourth international AAA league, which would go with the American Association, the International League, and the Pacific Coast League. This would be the Colored League, which would be the fourth, and Mr. Rickey and I met on several occasions. Mr. MacPhail said that he had something else to do and he couldn't make it. That's when Branch Rickey decided that, well, it looks like Larry is not going to be able to join us. So I think we'll just have to disband this idea.
I think Rickey was really sensitive to the notion that somehow baseball integration would become a political football. So I think a lot of his calculations, a lot of his planning went into keeping the unfolding of integration as far from the Communist Party as possible.
Referring to Rickey, black journalist Ludlow Werner predicted, "It will be a cold day in hell when that big windbag puts a Negro into a Brooklyn uniform."
We felt that this was a case where Mr. Rickey and the Dodgers did not like the idea of a hammer being put over their head, somebody coming in and just telling him that you have to do this. And that's the reason we took the position that it would be more advantageous to do it diplomatically.
There was certainly a lot of pressure building up, political pressure building up in America to make this happen. So I think that Mr. Rickey was acting in concert with his times, but he had a lot of courage to do it in the face of the opposition within baseball.
In 1945, reacting to pressure from the left and from black columnist Wendell Smith, the Red Sox gave Robinson and two other Negro leaguers a tryout in Fenway Park. The organizers hoped the tryout would bring attention to the cause, but the country's emotions were directed elsewhere.
Aboard a special train beginning the 24-hour trip back to Washington, the 31st President of the United States leaves Warm Springs forever. And all along the 700-mile route, people gather to honor President Roosevelt and his ideals.
There was a tremendous desire for change in America. We had been exposed to the world, too. Large numbers of black men had fought in the Second World War and had come back with a wider view of the world.
After World War II, when black soldiers who had fought in the war came home and tried to behave as Americans, claim their constitutional rights, throughout the South there was a huge backlash to keep blacks in their place, to keep the segregation laws rigid, to prevent blacks from voting. And some of that spilled over into the North.
During the years following the war, baseball broke all attendance records. But underneath the prosperity, the game suffered from its silent shame. Rickey identified the first Negro League signee, pitcher John Wright. But Rickey also wanted someone who would be in the lineup every day.
As a matter of fact, Robinson wasn't the first choice. Don Newcomb was. But Mr. Rickey, in his infinite wisdom, decided that Newcomb was too young. He was 18 years of old at that time.
When faced with so many talented black athletes who were out there, why would somebody go and pick Jackie Robinson to break the color barrier? He seemed to be far from the perfect person. Robinson's every fiber in his body was strike back, strike back, strike back. He was too proud an individual to ever turn the other cheek.
In August 1945, Dodger coach Clyde Sukesforth delivered Robinson to Rickey at 215 Montague Street. Greeting Robinson on his arrival that day were Paul Robeson and Benjamin Davis.
I was fortunate enough to have heard my grandfather recreated. My grandfather set about interrogating Jackie Robinson. And he said, what if you are covering a base and the ball is thrown to you and you tag a player out and he jumps out and jumps up in your face and he shouts at you and spits at you and he says, you black so-and-so, what are you going to do? He got in Jackie's face and he yelled at him full volume. When Jackie Robinson was confronted with that situation, he said, Mr. Rickey, do you want me to turn the other cheek? He realized he had a man here who was capable in powerful emotional situations of using his brain.
They were both religious men. They were both men who were very competitive. They were both men who were very committed to others. And I think one reason they hit it off and began to trust each other so early on in the relationship is because they could see these reflections of themselves in each other.
At the conclusion of the meeting, Rickey paraphrased from the Bible, whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also.
And that was one of the apprehensions of the guys in the Negro League. Man, the first time somebody called Jackie one of them names, pow, and it's all over.
3 months after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Rickey signed Jackie Robinson to a AAA contract. In 1945, Rickey told sports writer Arthur Mann, I don't mean to be a crusader, My only purpose is to be fair to all people, and my selfish objective is to win games.
We knew with this was going to open a lot of other doors. I can eat any place I want to. You know what I mean? I can shop any place I want to. Now my wife can go to a store and try on a dress or try on a hat if she wanted to.
My dad played baseball, and somehow he had a vision that one day blacks will be able to play Major League Baseball. I didn't, so I wasn't inspired to play the game. But when he found out that Jackie Robinson had signed with the Brooklyn Dodgers, then he came into the room the next day, and he was just smiling, and I mean, he had a wonderful smile on his face. And finally he sat down on the bed and said, "Son, Jackie Robinson just signed with the Brooklyn Dodgers, and blacks can play in the major leagues. And one day, you're going to be playing in the major leagues."
Until Jackie broke the color line, we had no way of knowing that there was a future for us in the major leagues. So it just opened up a whole set of doors for me to help me realize that if I worked hard, I could accomplish what Jackie had accomplished.
Jackie was the guy. Jackie was the key guy. And all us coming along, I think if I had to owe anybody, it would have been Jackie.
There was a criticism that the black leagues would suffer from it, and we had put quite a number of black people out of work. And my answer to them was that Abraham Lincoln put 4,000 people out of work when he abolished slavery. But so that while it was an institution, it also was a symbol of separate but equal.
You know, the war ended in 45, and this was 47, and there were black people, you know, being lynched and being killed. Awful things were happening. So Jackie was something you could always point to and say, "You see, there's Jackie. If he can do it, why can't the rest of us do it?"
Early on, I don't think we quite understood the impact of breaking a barrier or being pioneers. It soon came home to us, obviously, when we had to face the reaction on the other side and the opposition to it and the challenges. But initially, we were just thrilled as two 20, 23-year-old kids or young people would be to have a job and to be able to get married.
The darling of Brooklyn was outfielder Dixie Walker, the people's choice. A hardline segregationist from Birmingham, Walker commented, "As long as he's not with the Dodgers, I'm not worried."
You're afraid of anything you don't know anything about. It's like a little green door. You don't know what's going to come out when you open it. And a lot of people didn't understand and didn't know it.
In April 1946, Jackie Robinson and his bride embarked on the most important journey of their life together. Mally Robinson prepared hard-boiled eggs and fried chicken wings and put them in his shoebox for the long trip. Reluctantly, Jackie accepted his mother's gift. To him, it represented an old stereotype of blacks waiting for the train north. All was fine until the Robinsons tried to make a connecting flight in New Orleans. They were continually bumped from outgoing flights and denied access to the airport restaurant. Jackie and Rachel gladly ate from Mally's shoebox. In Pensacola, the Robinsons and a Mexican passenger were forced to deplane. Jackie and Rachel took the bus to Daytona.
I'd held up very well until we got on the bus and the driver made us move to the back seat. So we had to very docilely move to the back seat and could not even react to the bus driver's command. And it was like watching a man being reduced to a boy, the South's boy, when he couldn't fight back and didn't dare to. And part of me wanted him to, part of me knew he shouldn't. So being caught up in that conflict was very distressing to me. And I did cry when we got in the darkness of the bus and I thought Jack couldn't see me. I didn't want him to feel that, and he had failed me in any way.
In Florida, black fans traveled as far as 200 miles to see their new hero.
and they trained in my hometown of Daytona Beach. So we were very excited because we were going to get first look at Jackie. We was hoping and praying that the conditions would change, that somehow a Messiah would come and help show the way and show the world that, hey, blacks can excel, they can be responsible, they can be just as good as any other citizen in this country.
In Sanford, a local sheriff personally ushered Robinson off the field for breaking Jim Crow laws. A game in DeLand was called because of problems with the lights. It was an afternoon game.
All those places were, again, tests of our endurance because we had to live with the racial epithets. We had to live with the refusal to take us into hotels and where we had to find our own lodging. We had to deal with all of the manifestations of racism.
Despite all this, Robinson led the International League in hitting in 1946. A writer for the Montreal Daily Star commented, like plastics and penicillin, it seems like Jackie is here to stay. In 1946, Ricky met with all 16 owners. They would vote on Ricky's proposal to sign an African-American player to a major league contract.
To think that he could approach a situation which was so obvious to him, so inherent in the democratic processes of the United States government, and be so totally rebuffed, 15-1, I think overshadowed everything outside of that arena. Within your own institution, you're a pariah. And that was, I think that was a scarring experience for him.
Horace Stoneham, who owned the New York Giants, said white fans would burn down the polo grounds. Despite the overwhelming and emotionally charged votes against his plan, Ricky continued his pursuit of Commissioner Happy Chandler.
Happy Chandler, in my judgment, became a very fine commissioner. Although he had a background that was not suggestive of impartiality, racial impartiality. He came in with that background, became a figure very much in the image of Hugo Black. People who do remember him was a bigot, a confirmed bigot, and became one of the most liberal members of Congress later on.
Ricky also needed the support of black community leaders in Brooklyn.
He went to the church leaders in the black community in New York City. The black fans could not turn out to the stadium and, in essence, rub the white fans' noses in it.
And he basically said that if Jackie Robinson fails, if he doesn't succeed, it's going to be your fault. It's going to be the black community's fault. And some Negro leaders were disturbed by that. Many people in the community were outraged by it.
Despite a roar from owners Tom Yorkey, Sam Braden, and Larry McPhail, Ricky received confirmation from Chandler in the fall of 46. The following season, Robinson would be a big leaguer. Now the real controversy began.
Well, my great-grandmother, when Jackie Robinson first, when she heard that he was first going to be on the Brooklyn Dodgers, she was worried that he was going to die, that he would never be able to go in and out of St. Louis. She was worried about St. Louis a lot.
That spring, Commissioner Chandler suspended Dodger manager Leo DeRocher for conduct detrimental to baseball. On opening day, Bird Schotten was at the Dodger helm. 1947, Major League Baseball's 71st year, would be one of its most trying.
We must remember what America was like in the 40s. We cannot consider today's values, today's times, when we evaluate what those players did and what the white players on that team had to go through.
Amid terrible controversy, Brooklyn ushered in the first black major league player in the 20th century. Ricky tried to sidestep the racial issue at home by moving spring training to Havana, Cuba. But tension boiled over in the clubhouse, especially among the Southern players.
Many of them were simply loyal to their background, their tradition, I think it was Dixie Walker, or actually Harry Walker, Dixie's brother, who once said, I have nothing against them, the black players, but I have to go home to Alabama when this baseball season is over. I have to sell hardware to my neighbors. My neighbors are not going to tolerate the fact that I sat next to a black baseball player on a bench, or I supported a black baseball player. So we're talking about almost 100 years of cultural history being dramatically jolted.
Carfarillo was the only one I heard who was born and raised in the North voice any objection to Jackie Robinson. And I think it was just maybe not a real sincere feeling, but just he's letting it out. I don't want to play against that black son of a bee. I don't want to play with that black son of a bee. You know, and two or three of the players heard it, and the word got around that here's Carl, he don't want to play with Jackie.
Third baseman Archie Vaughn would go along with the mob. Eddie Stanky was reluctant. Southerner Pee Wee Reese wasn't talking. Other Southern players were not so discreet. Aside from Walker, there was pitcher Hugh Casey from Atlanta, Kirby Higbee, who used to throw rocks at blacks in his hometown of Columbia, South Carolina, and third-string catcher from Alabama, Bobby Bregan, whom the other players jokingly called Nig because of his dark complexion.
My father was a contractor, and he had about 20 blacks working, and they would come by the house during the week and want an advance of $2 or $3 something. They always go to the back door. Nobody black came to the front door in those days. When you grow up under those conditions, there's a segregation that's automatic because you got white fountains and black fountains. You got white bathrooms and black bathrooms. And it's just a white school and a black school. It's just a way of life.
Harry Walker of the Cardinals and brother Dixie were the second generation of Walkers to play in the major leagues.
And he, you know, basically jumped back and forth. And Dixie's trying to hit, and he finally told him, said, hey, it's hard enough to hit, but when you're doing that, I can't concentrate on the pitcher and all. And if you don't mind, Jack, and Jackie told him, said, hey, I worry about Jackie Robinson, you worry about you.
Ricky needed an ally within the ranks of his team.
Well, I guess if there's any one thing was, that really made an impression on me, when I was a kid, and my father took out and showed to me this one particular tree, he said, that's where a rope has been thrown over that limb, and there's been a few black that's been hanged there. In Louisville, you didn't go to school with the blacks. They weren't allowed in the park. You had to be in the stay in the back of the bus or the back of the streetcars. So you were used to black guys, but always staying in the background. But when I shook a hand with him, I had never done that before. It was strange.
Some of the guys were playing cards. Robinson was an avid card player. Hugh Casey was one of the people involved. I don't remember the other guys who were involved. At one point, Casey reached over and rubbed Robinson's scalp, and Robinson obviously was boiling because of that. Casey, I think, also referred to him as a boy in some sort of way. And the insult was really deep one. And Casey was unaware, I think, of what it was he had triggered in Robinson.
Dixie Walker and some of the other players, Hugh Casey, came over to me and says, how in the hell can you play cards, sit down and play cards with this guy? I said, what's wrong with it? You know, he didn't rub off on me or anything. I said, look, Dixie, I said, when you come north, you brought a black lady with you to take care of your children. I said, what's the difference?
That spring, a petition circulated in the Dodger clubhouse. Team captain Pee Wee Reese's support of the petition was considered crucial because of his friendship with baseball commissioner and fellow Kentuckian, Happy Chandler.
I never saw a petition a written paper whereby you had an opportunity to sign it if you didn't want Jackie Robinson to join. It's a figment of somebody's mind, because I never saw it. If there was a petition down there,
So help me God, I never saw it.
Well, that's a fallacy, because the petition was brought in Pete Reese's and Pee Wee Reese's room, and we both refused it to sign it. So that's, I know there was a petition.
But what in the world changed Pee Wee to make him, if he needed changing at all? I'm not saying he did, but you couldn't have been any more approachable than Pee Wee was with Jackie. And I think Jackie really confided in Pee Wee.
There's a very celebrated meeting that was called by Leo DeRocher, where he went after the guys who were in that room saying, I don't care if Robinson is black, yellow, green, red, or was striped like a zebra. If he can play and win for us, he's here.
Mr. Rickey called us in one-on-one, and interviewed. Understand you have an objection to playing with Jackie. Well, I wouldn't say it was a real strong objection, but I don't want to be the scapegoat in this thing, but, well, he said, are you going to play any different if he's here? Are you going to play just as hard if he's here? Or if he wasn't here? Yes, sir. But you'd rather be traded than stay here? Yes, sir, I'd rather be traded.
Before the season began, Dixie Walker sent a letter to Branch Rickey asking to be traded.
Jackie Robinson did not know on opening day that he was there, because a little junkie, Italian American named Pete Cascione, who happened to be a communist out of Brooklyn, was the spark that fueled that great flame.
Opening day, Ebbets Field, 1947. Willa Mae Robinson watched with proud concern as her little brother stood at attention during the playing of the national anthem.
Here's the way my brother stands, like this all the time. That's it. And I got sitting by some lady, look at him. That's Jackie Robinson. Look, he thinks he's something. And I wanted to slap her. I said, no, I can't do this, because the lady doesn't know Jackie Robinson, and she don't know me or anything. I said, he is not smiling. He is out there crying, and I know what he's thinking. I know, because his thoughts and his words are mine.
In Pittsburgh, the Pirates almost refused to take the field. In Chicago, there were closed-door meetings between players. In St. Louis, there was a rumor of a strike. Death threats followed Robinson everywhere.
His first year, it was terrible. He had nobody. When he got over with baseball during the day, then baseball is over, he go in and get dressed and leave the park and go on home. No friends yet.
But we sat together at the ball game early in the season in 1947. It was a night game. And after the game was over, I said, well, Rachel, we'll go downstairs, you know, and she said, fine. And so we walked along, and I didn't realize that when I went in the gate, she stood outside. And after I got in and realized she wasn't there, I went back outside the gate and brought her in and introduced her to the wives that were there. The newspapers got hold of it. It was in Chicago papers and several papers. And Clyde got some mail about me, but I didn't know it. They shielded me from that. That mail went to the Dodgers, you know, Ebbets Field, and I never saw it.
Later in the season, the controversy heightened when Cardinal outfielder Enos Slaughter spiked the Dodger first baseman during a routine play.
Yes, I stepped on Jackie. All hell broke out, I think, in 47, where Red Barber and one of the writers in New York wrote this book, and they both said, I intended to step on Jackie to try to get him out of the game.
Enos Slaughter was a guy that played hard. I didn't care who it was, if he coming in at second base, he's going to try to take you out.
Enos was driving once in spring training. His wife fell out of the car. He kept on driving.
I played the game hard. I never take anything for granted. I give no odds and ask none. I like to be friends with everybody, but when I got on the ball field, I was out there for one purpose. For whatever uniform that I was wearing, I was out to win for him.
The most vocal club against Robinson was the Philadelphia Phillies, led by their firebrand manager, Ben Chapman, another product of Alabama.
I remember they said that Ben had a $500 fine for anybody that didn't get on Jackie.
I think as much has been written about what Jackie went through, not enough has been said, because it was too vulgar, and too vicious for anybody to ever expose it. The things that were said to him and done to him by the opposing players, it was worse than anything that I have ever read.
I got so angry at Dixie Walker, who I used to love and want the leader of revolt, and Ben Chapman, who sent the black cat out to home plate, and I couldn't understand it, so I double-rooted for Jackie.
Well, Ben was like that with everybody. It didn't matter whether Jackie Robinson or Harry Walker. He had a way of gouging the good Lord.
There's certain traditions in baseball that everybody knows about, and Jack was fully aware of them. But you can cross the line. I mean, you can slide in a base and try to knock a guy over, but it's different when you slide in a base with your spikes high and attempt to hurt him. And it's the same way with the bench jockeying. There comes a point where it's clear what the aim is, and that is to embarrass and humiliate.
Ben was a tough guy. I remember one day we were going in after Jackie had a big day against him, and we crossed in that runway going down to the Phillies and Dodger clubhouse in Ebbets Field, and Ben said to Jackie, "Jackie, you're one fine baseball player, but you're still a nigger."
Even Chapman's close friend Dixie Walker said Chapman had gone too far. The abuse clearly took its toll. Early on, Robinson showed no authority with the bat. He went hitless in 14 trips to the plate.
I think it was the beginning of the civil rights movement. And to be a significant part, as I think Jack was, is highly motivating. And so you feel like you can put up with almost anything.
Jackie Robinson was a champion of his people. And he carried himself like a champion. In the way he cocked that bat, the way he stared out at the pitcher, the way he would dance off a base and just dare the pitcher to try and catch him off. I mean, that was saying a great deal beyond his batting average or how many bases he stole.
This guy was fired up enough that he would fight twice as hard. It was almost like, don't wake up the sleeping dog, he might bite you.
The dog woke up. Robinson's 21-game hitting streak led the Dodgers to their first National League pennant since 1941. 1.8 million people passed through the Ebbets Field turnstiles in 1947, a National League attendance record. Wendell Smith of the Pittsburgh Courier wrote, "Jackie's nimble, Jackie's quick, Jackie's making the turnstiles click."
He was one of the most exciting baseball players I ever saw. I would like to have seen him play in today's times and see how many bases he could steal. He was a big guy. He was a big man. He weighed over 200 pounds and had terrific speed and could get the quickest start on stealing a base of anyone I ever saw.
He would come into the clubhouse with a big smile on his face and say hello to everybody and go to his locker, which was in the back of the locker room, and you could see when he was putting his uniform on, he'd put his game face on with that uniform, and you could just see that look in his eye that he was getting ready. He was getting his mind ready to go out and beat somebody.
Robinson was baseball's Rookie of the Year and its best bargain at $5,000 a season, the major league minimum. Ben Chapman was quoted as saying, "Robinson is a major leaguer in every respect."
Ben had a $500 fine for anybody that didn't get on Jackie in 47 when he came up, you know. And then in 48, he had a $500 fine if anybody got on Jackie, because he just wore the Phillies out in 47.
In the first game of the 47 series, Robinson gave Phil Rizzuto a taste of things to come. But that year, it was the Dodgers who licked their wounds as the Yankees collected winning World Series checks.
This was a very strong feeling in my community, which was a Jewish community. I mean, I went to a high school, Horace Mann, which was overwhelmingly Jewish. And Jackie Robinson was the great hero. And to me, you know, seeing him, his struggle, you know, his courage and his gallantry and the real dignity with which he carried on this wonderful fight.
That winter, the people's choice, Dixie Walker, was traded to Pittsburgh for future Boys of Summer, Billy Cox and Preacher Rowe.
Fortunately, I stayed, but Dixie Walker put it in writing, and Mr. Rickey accommodated him the next year and traded him to Pittsburgh.
Before Walker left, he was being booed by both black and white fans in Brooklyn.
Somebody said Dixie Walker's leaving because Jackie Robinson. That wasn't all. They had a lot of good young players coming in, outfielders in other position, and he could see himself sitting on the benches going to nothing. He didn't want that. He wanted to finish playing and then make his own terms to get out. And he did that when he went with the Pirates. Rickey was getting to the end of where if he doesn't win, he might not be there. He's got the contract to produce and get paid good money. What did he do? He went out and got Jackie, Campanella, Newcomb, and a couple of more of the top ball players. That turned his whole organization around. And it wasn't in the goodness of Rickey's heart to do this. It was for Rickey's pocketbook as much as anything in my books.
Dixie Walker finally came back to the Dodgers as a hitting coach, and he openly apologized for being that way with Jackie, which was that's the type of fellow Dixie Walker was.
It really doesn't make any difference. He's dead and gone. His days are over. He did his job. It's in the book. What else? Nothing else.
In July 1948, I had a call from Mr. Branch Rickey at my apartment. He said, Bobby, would you be interested in going down to Fort Worth in the Texas League and being a catcher manager? And I said, yes, sir, I would. Looking back, it was the greatest contribution that I ever made to the Dodgers because I made room for Roy Campanella. He took my spot.
Went to every corner of the country. It raised the dream in people in Jacksonville, Florida, in Seattle, Washington, in Minneapolis, Minnesota, in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. It raised it everywhere, in people who were bigoted, and people who were tolerant, and people who had a passion for justice, and people who were going to fight their, you know, to the dying day to preserve segregation.
When I went back home that fall in 47, the fall of 47, I played City League basketball. And I had a chance to break our city scoring record. And they put two guys on me to guard me, and they both said, well, you ain't going to break this record. We're going to break your arm, you nigger lover. And boy, oh boy, I broke that record. You better believe I did.
I do not need to remind you that the question arising not only at London, but also out of almost every news dispatch these days is, what is Russia up to now?
In 1948, the Soviet blockade of Berlin ruled the headlines. The U.S. defeated the blockade and airlifted supplies to the besieged German city. Back in the States, the House Un-American Activities Committee reportedly investigated 2 million government employees for communist involvement.
Yeah, it's a tough life this spring training. Just pipe this layout at the Haragua Hotel pool. And tricks, too, by mermaids with free wheeling. Baseball is everything, and them bums who gave the Yankees such a fright last year are right in the swim.
That year, the Dodgers trained in the Dominican Republic, away from the tension and controversy of the previous season. In Vero Beach, Florida, Rickey converted an old naval air station into a complex baseball facility where black and white players could eat, play, and train together without outside interference. He called it Dodger Town. In 1948, the Lip was back in uniform. DeRocher and Robinson were incompatible.
Leo was the number one man in Brooklyn for years, remember. There was no one like Leo in Brooklyn, according to Leo. And when Jackie, in 1948 and 49, Jackie became his own man. And even more so after Mr. Rickey left the Dodgers. And I think Leo resented Jackie, to be honest with you.
The Dodgers are off to a sour start. Leo wanted Robinson and Reese as a double play combination. It was one of the few things DeRocher and Rickey agreed on that year.
You're never going to have a great shortstop without a very good second baseman. You're never going to have a great second baseman without a very good shortstop. Because the whole thing has to flow like a ballet. And what they could do better than anybody else playing baseball at that time, and maybe at all time, was the dance around second base. I mean, to watch their timing and to watch their interaction around the base was clearly an artistic thing.
They were magical around the bag, a duo that was the heart and soul, in a metaphorical way, and, in a real way, of the Brooklyn Dodgers. One white, one black, two extremely talented baseball players playing together. And wherever they went, St. Louis, Cincinnati, Philadelphia, wherever they went, people got to see that. And in my opinion, that was as important for America as, you know, any other part of the civil rights movement that came later.
They always give me a lot of credit for helping Jackie, and I hope and pray that I did help him, because I would like to be remembered for doing something for the band. And he did give me a lot of credit. But I think the person that really should have the credit for really making it easier for him was for his wife, Rachel.
Robinson hit .296 and stole 22 bases in 1948 and led the league in being hit by pitches. Late in the season, Robinson and umpire Butch Henlein get into a hot dispute after a close play at second. Robinson was ejected. Jackie said of Henlein, "He was treating me like any other ball player who got on his nerves. The Ebony Express, as one reporter nicknamed him, had taken flight."
He was going to be allowed and able to be himself, and fully that, so that he, if he felt like challenging an umpire, he could do that with impunity. If he felt like taking a stand against something that he felt was negative for the team, he could be himself. And I think that being himself was reflected in his play, because his play became much better.
By 1949, the Dodgers had three of the eight African-American players in the major leagues.
By my parents talking about that, and the expression of who Jackie Robinson was, who Roy Campanella was, who Don Newcomb was, Joe Black, and they were all with the Dodgers. So you'd hear expressions like, quick like Jack Robinson, and things like that. So therefore, the Dodgers became my team.
Black players were now on rosters throughout Brooklyn's huge minor league organization. Robinson announced from Vero Beach, "Everybody better be prepared to be rough this year, because I'm going to be rough on them."
There were fans waiting for Jack at the clubhouse door, both black and white. There were many indications that that he was there to stay and that he was being accepted. And we were in a neighborhood where we felt comfortable and enjoyed our neighbors. We had a child and we had started a family. So on the personal side, things were going very, very well for us. So by 1949, I really felt that we were ready to be a full part of the whole experiment.
Mr. Rickey had been the leash, and that was gone, and he was going to let loose. And if it hadn't been for, as I said, his good friend Pee-wee, Jackie might have got himself in trouble.
In what way?
Outspoken. He was now, and he didn't listen to anyone at the time, on the field. He was a different player on the field. He was belligerent, tough.
And a lot of times, he'd bunt that ball down the first baseline, and I've seen guys not cover that first base. The pitcher's not get over there, because he'd try to run over you.
Droscher told me he was the most vicious bench jockey he had ever seen in his life. He was earthy, he was to the core. He talked about your mother and your wife in extremely intimate terms. This very dark black man was a vicious, vicious competitor.
We were down in Florida in spring training, and Ben Chapman was coaching third base. I threw the ball to Jackie, and he acted like it hurt his hand. Well, it didn't hurt his hand, but Ben Chapman said something like, "Hey, Pee-wee, don't hurt little Jackie's hands now." He said, "Look, Chapman, you've been on my tail for a couple years. Now then, I am a major leaguer. I'm not the first black. I'm a major league baseball player now. And if I hear any more out of you, I guarantee you I'm going to meet you after this game. We're going to see what happens." And we didn't get any more from Chapman at that time.
Slaughter hits a ball off the wall in right field. Ferrillo grabs it, throws it in. Robinson's at second. Slaughter slides in, and Robinson knocks out his three front teeth. And said to Slaughter, "I never forget." Slaughter said, "I respected him to the day he died right after that."
Ricky had one more barrier to bring down, the Deep South. In 1949, Ricky took his club to the heart of Ku Klux Klan country. Dr. Green, the Grand Dragon of the KKK, warned of repercussions.
The stories that really got to me was when the Dodger plane arrived in Atlanta and the team got off the plane, that after all of that brouhaha about what the Grand Kliga was going to do, Pee Wee walked over to a rock on off the tarmac, turned it over and looked up and said, "I don't see no Grand Kliga crawling out from under here."
Dick Young, a tough reporter for the New York Daily News, heightened the tension in Atlanta when he interviewed Dr. Green.
Dick Young, as soon as we got into town, called him ostensibly to interview him on his thoughts on why he would want to set up a boycott. What's wrong with a black player? See, he got that two races apart routine from the doctor, and Young says, "Well, doctor, you're a pediatrician, aren't you?" The guy says, "Yeah." He says, "What would happen if someone brought a black kid in who was terribly sick? Would you treat him or not?" See, and the guy sputtered a while, and the thing degenerated, and Young hung up, and he turned to me. He says, "Listen," "these phones are probably tapped." He says, "You better lock your door at night."
Robinson received more death threats.
It's surprising the mail that he would get, and to the extent where he had show it to me, he'd show me, call me over to his locker, and he would show me about, "Jackie, if you play in today's game, you will be killed, you will be shot."
Willa Mae Robinson called from Pasadena and begged her brother not to play.
There was a note there telling him in the third inning. There was a note when he left home. There was a note on the bus. There was a note when he got to the park. There was a note in his dress. Everywhere he had to go before he got to the field, he had a note telling him in the third inning. And I'm telling him, "Don't go, don't go." "Oh, yeah, I'm going."
And I read the letter, and Jackie said, "Are you going to the stadium?" I said, "Are you going?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Did Roy read the letter?" He said, "Yes." "Are you going?" "Yes, I'm going." And we went to that field, and they escorted us out on the field, two men on each side of us going on the field, thinking somebody was going to really shoot us as they threatened in the letter.
Birdshot called the meeting and said, "Look, we have something going on here. Jackie's been threatened with these letters. He says, someone's threatened to shoot him today. And we all got uptight." Bert says, "Does anyone have any suggestions, you know?" Nothing said for a while. I said, "Why don't we all wear number 42? They won't know who the hell hit."
Back in Pasadena, the Robinson family could do nothing but listen.
And we had to imagine things, you know, because it wasn't TV then. I could hear the bullet, imagine him falling, you know. So we had to imagine everything in that minute by minute.
Well, we were so afraid and so frightened. In that game that I pitched, Jackie Robinson went 3-for-4. Roy Campanella hit 3 home runs, and I pitched a 2-hit shutout. That's how frightened we were.
Over the 3-game series, a record 50,000 people packed into the 12,000-seat Ponce de Leon Stadium in Atlanta. Dan Parker of the Daily Mirror commented, "A powerful blow has been struck against the color line. Those whom Robinson did not capture with his courage, he captured with his play. During the series, he batted a torrid 412. One letter to him simply stated, 'Hope you make it, black boy.' Signed, white boy." Jackie Robinson was now the toast of intellectuals, liberals, and the cultural elite.
I was in college. I was a junior in college when Jackie came up to the major leagues. And I remember asking Dad, "Look, get me Jackie's autograph, please. And so Dad told me, well, I can't do that. I said, what do you mean you can't do that? I mean, get his autograph. But he said, no, I can't do that. And he explained. He said, I'm now being attacked in the media as an enemy of the state, as a communist, as a traitor. And he said to me, if Jackie had his picture taken with me, which is what would happen, he might lose his career. I'm not going to put Jackie in that position, even for you.
By the late 40s, Cold War fears were escalating. Robeson fueled those fears when he told a French audience that African Americans would not fight in a war against the Russians.
So Dad was acutely aware that he could be killed, I mean, that his life was in danger if he continued on his political course. And Dad wasn't about to change his views. And both my mother and I said, well, you know, you do what you have to do. So I think we lived with that danger. I think Jackie Robinson, in a different context, learned to live with it, especially because he was so outspoken. So in that sense, there was a similarity.
Jackie Robinson was invited by the House Un-American Activities Committee to give lie to Robeson's statement. Rookie saw this as an opportunity to denounce communism.
Dad wasn't surprised that Jackie Robinson, the first black player in baseball, would be called down to make a statement denouncing Paul Robeson. As a matter of fact, he told me if Jackie had refused and forced them to subpoena him, he would have never had a baseball career. His career would have ended immediately. So he didn't expect Jackie to make that sacrifice.
Free to worship as I please.
At Ricky's urging, Robinson testified, calling Robeson's comments silly. He then took the opportunity to rebuke Jim Crow before the committee.
Colored Americans you meet will tell you the same thing. But that doesn't mean that we're going to stop fighting race discrimination in this country until we've got it licked. It means that we're going to fight it all the harder because our stake in the future is so big, we can win our fight without the communists, and we don't want their help.
Actually, the committee was not at all happy with his testimony, but it couldn't hang him because he had, quote, criticized Paul Robeson and said, well, at least indirectly, and said that he was a loyal American, so he got away with it. But he was taking a considerable risk to say even what he said. What people don't realize is the situation he was in, and he's been unjustly, in Dad's view then, and in my view now, accused of, quote, being an Uncle Tom by going down and attacking and condemning Paul Robeson for the white American elite.
While liberals believed he had lost sight of the cause, many of his teammates thought he was becoming too political.
The only criticism I had of Jackie was I thought he agitated in a way that didn't always gain him enough points. I wanted him to gain points every time. And he did, a lot of them. But in some ways, he was too intense to wait.
I looked out the window in the clubhouse in the St. Louis Cardinal Stadium one day, and I saw, and this is 1949, maybe 1950, 10,000 black people standing in the street when there's only 3,000 seats available for them in the bleachers. I said, what are you going to do, Robbie? He said, I'm not going to play tonight. Campy, you're not going to play tonight. We're not going to play. We're going to take the uniform off. And it seemed somehow somebody heard it, because those stands the next trip opened up to everybody.
The Sporting News reported, a problem grows in Brooklyn. Robinson should be a player, not a crusader.
When he got angry, probably too much was made of it by the white press. He was going to be a guy like everybody else. If something bothered him, he'd let you know it. But that was a shock. In 1949, 1950, 1951, blacks didn't behave that way. But when Robinson behaved that way, it literally became a whole new ball game in the country.
With Ricky's ban on Robinson's endorsements lifted, Jackie's likeness was plastered on everything from dolls to caps to candy bars. His good looks and poise made him the darling of talk shows and the banquet circuit. He shared star billing with Ruby Dee in the film, The Jackie Robinson Story.
Suppose I finish out the year. I'm no further along than when I started. No closer to getting a half-decent job, so I can afford it.
He had a boyish,
unease about him, and he also, there was a kind of a twinkle in his eye, and a little bit of anger in his face. That's how I remember him.
Ricky continued to pay Robinson a modest $20,000 a year salary, $80,000 less than that of baseball's former ace drawing card, Joe DiMaggio.
He was a man that Jack and I both respected, both trusted. And he was not paternal. He was not paternalistic as some have portrayed him. He could be paternal and caring, but we never felt he exploited us.
But I will say to you that from my grandfather's point of view, there was a man-to-man love there that I don't think you're going to find greater love between two men in many situations. It was a love of a very, very, very deep respect and a bond to sharing the same cause.
In 1950, Walter O'Malley replaced Ricky as the Dodger president.
Anyone that mentioned the word Mr. Ricky was fined a dollar. And that went on for 10 years. And we made a lot of money. Now, there was no love lost between Mr. Ricky and Mr. O'Malley.
O'Malley became rich from investments in the Long Island Railroad and the Brooklyn Union Gas Company. A lover of power, poker, and Churchill cigars, the former team attorney was about to take the Dodgers to a new era. In 1950, O'Malley told columnist Red Smith that the integration of baseball had been his idea.
Jackie never gave Walter O'Malley credit for having a piece of the action when he was brought up to the big leagues. See, there were three owners at the time. It was Walter O'Malley, Jim Mulvey, and John Smith. And they all had to agree to bring Jackie into the big leagues. And Jackie didn't realize that. He thought that it was Mr. Ricky. It wasn't Mr. Ricky. It was the team. And never at once did he give Walter O'Malley due respect.
I do know that there was tension between Jack and Walter O'Malley. You never know what's racial and what isn't racial, and you always suspect there's some racial side of a dispute between a black and a white person. But I think it was, my thought is, it was more a question of loyalty, and that a feeling that Jack was extremely loyal to Branch Rickey and probably couldn't transfer that loyalty to Walter O'Malley.
In 1953, Robinson challenged baseball's last Jim Crow stronghold in the National League. Visiting white players stayed at the plush Chase Hotel in St. Louis. The African-American players had a bunk in at the Adams, a hotel in the black section of town.
Jackie felt that he had to be where the team was if he was going to continue to make any strides in breaking down racial barriers.
The black players lived in the Hotel Adams. They had air-conditioned rooms, very important in St. Louis in the summer. Not all of the Chase was air-conditioned. And they had a kind of a baronial lifestyle there. They were, you know, great celebrities. They would have to give that up to go to the Chase.
The owner of the hotel would pick them up in a limousine at the airport. We didn't have limousines for all the players. So they, in their own way, they were happy. But Jackie had a different attitude. Jackie was out to prove something.
We found the manager of the hotel. We want to know why we can't stay here. And he said, okay, I'm going to tell you. The only reason we don't want you here, and we thought about it a long time, is we don't want you men using swimming pool. Now they don't want us eating upstairs in the dining room. We had to eat in our rooms.
I do remember going back to the hotel. After we'd go down to the dining room and eat, we'd go up to the room, and we would pass the room service carts outside of Jackie's room. Looking back, it's kind of a mystery to me now. Well, wait a minute. Why didn't we stand up at the time and say, wait a minute. If he doesn't eat in the dining room, we don't eat in the dining room.
We had the audacity to want to play baseball and live in a hotel with our teammates because we were black. That was what we fought. That was what we were up in arms about. That's what Jackie was so bitter about. That's why Jackie died a bitter man.
By 1954, Robinson's fears rose when O'Malley fired manager Chuck Dressen. Replacing Dressen was a former minor league manager who had no experience at the big league level. Walter Alston was expected to manage a team of superstars.
Jackie Robinson was making a lot of statements to the press in New York about Will Wynn despite him. He's a rookie manager. I don't think he's going to know our players and things like that.
He enjoyed playing for Charlie Dressen, and Walter Austin was a different kind of manager and not one that he could develop rapport with.
That spring, Austin decided to platoon Robinson, who promptly displayed his frustrations. During an exhibition game in Louisville, the Robinson-Austin relationship exploded.
Well, the incident in Louisville was a tragic thing for the Dodgers. They did have an altercation, and Waller, I knew Waller. Waller was probably the strongest man I've ever seen in my life. And he called Jackie in the office in Louisville and locked the door and said, one of us is going to get out, Jackie.
Walter Austin all of a sudden confronted Jackie Robinson and said, let's go to Fifth City right now. And Roy jumped in between them and said, no, we can't have that happen on this team.
If they had gone to fisticuffs in that thing, I think that might have been the end of Walter Austin's career with the Dodgers. And it took a year for them to get to know Walton and realize that he wasn't quite as dumb as they thought he was.
The aging team awakened. The 1955 Brooklyn Dodgers clinched the pennant early. Then they dropped the first two games in the series. But the weary Dodgers came back to life when Robinson stole home in Game 6, igniting his team to its first and only World Series flag. Among Jackie's greatest baseball moments, it was also one of his last.
It's the Yankees versus the Dodgers at Ebbets Field in Brooklyn, and President Eisenhower joins 34,000 other baseball fans for the opening game of the World Series.
By 1956, the boys of summer had grown old. There would be one more clash between the boroughs. The Yankees' 9-0 seventh game victory drew the curtain on one of baseball's great rivalries. The last batter in the Subway Series, Jackie Robinson. He struck out. After the game, Robinson paid homage to his longtime rivals.
I don't know what I'm laughing about, to tell you the truth, but the Yogi here, the way I feel about it, had it not been for him, Nuke probably would have been in there a little longer, because he certainly was throwing as well as I've ever seen him throw. And this guy here, to me, is just as fine a clutch hitter as I've ever seen in the game today of baseball. It does a tremendous job.
That winter, O'Malley sold a shrine, Ebbets Field, to develop a Marvin Cratter. He then took the unimaginable one step further. He traded Jackie Robinson to the Giants.
And we thought we were doing Jackie a favor by selling to the Giants, because he could make a lot more money, he'd be closer to home. But it didn't work out that way. He thought that Waller O'Malley was opposed to his being a member of the Dodgers, which was not true at all.
Robinson elected to retire. In 1956, the year-long Montgomery, Alabama bus boycott was in full swing. Castro wanted Havana. Dwight Eisenhower was elected president, and Richard Nixon became vice president. Activist Eldridge Cleaver said that somewhere in the universe, the gears had shifted.
So what you saw in Brooklyn, as we start doing better, succeeding with Jackie Robinson, with Roy Campanella, with Joe Black, with Don Newcomb, Sonny Amaral, and all these fellas coming in to play for the Dodgers, I think you see increased dissatisfaction. Because you become aware of what you have been denied in the past. And you become angry retroactively. In Harlem, you saw the same destructive phenomenon.
By 1956, Branch Rickey's dream of racial harmony, a dream that had begun with Jackie Robinson 10 years earlier, appeared more complicated than ever.
What made it possible for us to have contact with each other, black and white, was Ebbets Field. And what made the blacks accepted was the excellence on the baseball field.
The Polo Grounds had bad parking, a diminishing fan base, and a location in a racially divided area. Giants owner Horace Stoneham wanted out. In 1957, O'Malley struggled with a new course for his team. 25 years after Jackie Robinson first came to Cincinnati as a big league ball player, the town that had scorned him now honored him.
Jackie had problems walking. He was not, but when he came out of there, I'm telling you, he was walking with his head high, and he looked great. And he came up when he got out there and got through, and I said, Jackie, that's the first time I've seen you walk like that in a long time. And he said, man, this may be my last walk, and I want to walk it proud. And he did.
I would just like to say that I was really just a spoke in the wheel of the success that we had some 25 years ago. And personally want to say thank you to a great captain, a guy who was the leader of our ball club and who really set the pace in many, many areas. Pee-wee, thanks so much for being here today. I would like to also say that I would be a real, real pleasure if Mr. Rickey could have been here with us today, but to the members of the family, my entire love and gratitude for the things that he's done over the years.
In Cincinnati, when I was injured and couldn't play in the World Series, I made an effort to go and see him because he was almost completely blind. Diabetes had taken his eyesight, and it wasn't long after that he passed on. But I wanted to meet him for me, to remember him, to just look in his face and feel his aura, feel his presence, because it was important.
But what Jackie did was to symbolize the struggle, to personalize it, and to present the struggle in a form that we could identify on a human level with. So he was an important part of the struggle, but we used him and his position always as an argument, you know, to achieve something else.
Abuse, racial abuse, ate at him right from the middle of his stomach on out through every cell in his body. And it probably did more to shorten Jackie Robinson's life than anything he ever did.
9 days after his last appearance in Cincinnati, on October 24th, 1972, Jackie Robinson died. He was 52.
I just feel like Jackie's death, barely 50 years old, came at a time when he felt like he hadn't really done all that he wanted to do.
He's always watching me. He's always there. He was tough. He was strong. I think that's the legacy, really, that Jackie brought to my life, is to keep going. Keep going.
And I'm terribly dismayed. Terribly dismayed to have to remember a few years ago when 25 black Major League Baseball players were asked who Jackie Robinson was. 19 of the 25 did not know. One said, after he found out who Jackie Robinson was, well, that's what Jackie Robinson was supposed to have done. That's an outstanding remark, I think, in the way of ignorance to respond to a question of who this great man was.
The news bulletin flashed that Jackie had died. I felt like that was something that, I don't know, had to be spoken, had to come out. So I got my little pencil and I started writing him down. He accepted the challenge and played the game with fervor that few men possessed. He stood up to the brunt of society's shame with talent that God had blessed. He banged out hits and electrified the fans with daring base running skills. This great, great player and proud black man, many biggest did threaten to kill. He ripped up the sod along the base path as he ran in advance of a base. Upon his feet were your hopes and mine for a victory for the black man's case. He opened up opportunities that never exist for the likes of you and me. This man from Georgia courageously assists in the dawning of an era for thee. And the world is grateful for the legacy which he left for all humanity. Thanks, Jackie, wherever you are. You will always be our first superstar. For history shall record and eternally proclaim your great deeds in its halls of fame. So go now, rest for a while,
For again you shall come a spirit of flame in the bosom of another black child that God and destiny shall name.